The Witcher is fucking awesome. The Netflix series, the games, and I'll bet the books. I haven't read them yet. I will. Anyway, that's the point is that I think I and many others love the idea of running and playing a Witcher-style game. And by that, I mean every fight should feel like a puzzle, like a deadly puzzle on time pressure that you've got to nerve-wrackingly figure out or die. There's more videos I could do on the subject, but let's just talk about monsters today, right? In games like The Witcher or Dark Souls, if you show up unprepped, you will get the absolute fuck beat out of you. Right? The monsters should be creepy and dangerous, but also should feel like a part of an ecosystem or a story, and there should be some kind of knack to defeating them easily. Let's start with making them deadly. Average the level of the group, add 3, that is the CR of the encounters that you should be building for your party. Take every monster that you're going to be using, that you just chose, and half their HP. Then give them extra resistances. In addition to their listed resistances, 1 specific damage resistance per CR and 1 damage immunity per 3 CR or 1 general resistance per 3 CR, something like a resistance to non-magical damage or something like that. So a CR4 creature should have 1 immunity and 4 resistances in addition to whatever they already have listed in the monster manual. Step 2, the knacks. The knack is all about offense and defense against the monster. Give them at least 1 damage vulnerability, something somewhat specific like piercing or fire damage. Then give them a lure, something to coax them out as bait into the trap that you have set with the other knacks. Something like, Umbra Hulks are attracted to the scent of flumph meat. Then, once you've lured them somewhere, you probably want to defeat them. Create specific measures players can take advantage of to make the fight easier. Something like damaging an Umbra Hulk's antenna disorients it, giving all incoming attacks advantage. Or Umbra Hulks can't move directly towards light. Or chewing on Valerian root gives you immunity to the Umbra Hulk's confusing gaze. There you go. Now you have a monster that you can build an entire adventure around, and if the players engage with the story, all the knacks should be discoverable. All right, I thought I was gonna be able to cover my potion and blade oil system, but I don't have that time. So just know that you should give them blade oils that do specific damage types or convert your sword or whatever hammer's damage type to something else.
I wanted to go over some stuff that I didn't have time to animate, which means that I've got to talk about it as a human being instead of as my avatar. I didn't really give a good justification for why those specific modifications were a good idea. And really, what it comes down to is the goal of those modifications are to make D&D monsters feel more like folklore monsters. Folklore monsters usually have a very specific way to take them down. And while we're on that, probably the puzzle should be, what is the monster that you're after, as opposed to knowing the monster in advance. Although that can be cool too. If you know exactly what the monster is in advance, that works as well. But usually the villagers will give you descriptions of a creature, and then your characters will figure out with their background knowledge, okay, so this could be one of these 3 or 4 creatures. Sometimes when I do this, I use a deck of many monsters and I'll give them like a hand from that deck that has like a werewolf of this, of that, of this, of that, whatever, like 5 things. And then they can, then as they're going through and figuring out clues, they'll get rid of cards from that deck until it's narrowed down to a few monsters. And in general, I would give them ways to research how to defeat those monsters, what their knacks are, or I would just let them know that they already know in advance, because they're monster hunters, these are the things that you need to do when you're up against a drowner. These are the things that you need to do when you're up against a striga. These are the things that you need to do when you're up against a cockatrice or whatever. Anyway, give them enough that they can figure everything out and they never feel cheated when they show up after getting a bunch of shit ready for a drowner and then they get wrecked by a cockatrice, right? All of that said, I'd like to give you a couple extra tips if you're going to follow the stuff from the animated video at the beginning. And that is, make vulnerabilities trump resistances so that no matter what, each creature has at least 1 damage vulnerability. you can come up with a big batch of like super specific damage vulnerabilities if you want to. So stuff like a blade wet with the blood of a hen, or the sword from a narrowly or shallowly buried grave, or the hammer of a betrayer. Sometimes it can also be fun to give specific vulnerabilities for magic, things like spells created by elves, or spells that are of a certain school can get through this creature's defenses. Keeping in mind, though, that you shouldn't do that all the time, because casters already have the advantage that they have more control over the damage types than, say, a barbarian, right? And they're going to be able to get through damage resistances and find vulnerabilities a lot more easily than, you know, your average tank. Also, once your monster has more resistances than not, it becomes a little bit easier to track the damage. If you take a look and you're like, my party is only doing damage to stuff that this thing is resistant to, then just don't have the HP. That first step of making, you know, during the making it deadly step where it's like you pick a higher CR monster and you have that, just don't have the HP. And when players do some damage to a monster like that that has no resistance to whatever the damage is, say that, you know, they're not resistant to bludgeoning, just make it do double damage. And then when they do damage against something that the monster is actually vulnerable to, then it'll do quadruple damage. And if you really want to have fun, let the player roll all of those dice, especially if there's a crit. That would be an absolutely bonkers crit. Now, keeping track of all of those numbers is going to be a little bit complicated. What I do, and I'm just admitting this to my group now, they don't know that I do this, I track it in rounded fives until I'm on the last 15 HP of a boss monster where those one or two HPs matter, because then you almost have like a health bar where you just go tick, 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 tick. Okay, this has six ticks, 30 HP. And every time somebody does seven damage, you're like, okay, is that closer to five or 10? That's how many ticks you're going to do. Whew. Okay, that was a ton. There's no sponsor this week. If you like my channel, you should check out MCDM, Adam Coble, Penny Arcade Seattle After Dark, and WebDM. Those are all awesome D&D channels. Happy 2020. 2019 was the best year I've ever had, professionally and personally. I've been traveling. I've been having a blast talking about D&D to people, and I'm just so excited that the hobby is blown up the way that it has. Now, all of that said, yes, I'm on camera, which I think I mentioned maybe briefly at the beginning. That's a little weird, but I don't have time to animate all of these like post notes, and I know a lot of times before a video even goes up what the questions are going to be, and I also know that people I'm not going to be able to respond to everybody, so this is a way to kind of in advance talk to people about some stuff. I'd also like to do some interviews as post notes occasionally, especially with people who design rules and that sort of thing, or tabletop series. And I think that's pretty much it. You know what to do. Bye.